Welcome to the USS Silversides Submarine Museum, a museum dedicated to the efforts and accomplishments of the veterans who fought in World War II. The museum behind me is a 15,000 square foot facility. We are located at 1346 Bluff Street in Muskegon, Michigan, very close to Pier Marquette Park and, of course, right on the channel that connects Muskegon Lake to Lake Michigan. Currently, there is a course on World War II history being offered at the museum every Monday night from 6 till 9 p.m. Two instructors from Muskegon Community College have developed this course, and in cooperation with the college, the class is being offered here at the museum. Throughout the 15 weeks, each evening we'll have a different instructor, a different speaker, a different presenter with a specific expertise. The class is attended by students who have enrolled for credit, and the museum has made the offer to the community members to attend this lecture series if they so wish, and do so free, and of course donations are graciously and generously accepted. The topics throughout the course, if I may read from the notes that I have about the course, began on January 7th with the topic of From Versailles to Munich, talking about the transition from World War I to World War II. Subsequent weeks cover the topics of the German Blitzkrieg crushing Poland, England Stands Alone, Hitler's Dilemma, Operation Barbarossa about Russia, Pearl Harbor, Awakening the Sleeping Giant, the Pacific Theater, Defeating the Desert Fox, and Muskegon, the Arsenal of Democracy.
Okay, onwards and upwards. We're going to get started with our program this evening, the Air War for over Britain. And it's going to be interesting because if you like Churchill, you like airplanes, this is the day. Kurt Troutman.
Good afternoon. Last week, I did my damnedest to pick a fight with everyone in this room. I could not have been any more supportive of the Third Reich and the Fuhrer and his regime. Yet, you were all so polite to let me off the hook. So, the point is, if you've got some comments, if you have clarifications, if you've got information we don't, do not hesitate to share that with us. We really want to make sure you get your say because you've got very good things to say. You really do. By no means do we have the market cornered on all that is knowledgeable here. So, tonight we're going to talk about the Battle of Britain, which in many ways was the very first air war. Yes, there were air campaigns during World War I, certainly a few dogfights. We all know about the Red Baron. We've all watched Snoopy. But in many ways, this was the first true air war. And like most things in history, we didn't know what was going to happen. At the beginning of this, Germany clearly had the superior air force. There's no question about that. What we see here is a historic embodiment of the many searchers. Many people in Britain were, volunteers with the government that were spotters. Spotters for the British military, what type of planes are coming, what type of armaments. So this is one of the many spotters that were common throughout this period, really throughout the entire war in Britain. German empowerment. Remember, we left off last week at mission accomplished. Greater Germany had been restored. Poland had been crushed. France had been brought under German domination. Germany is really feeling empowered. I cannot stress strong enough how much that Germany sought a peace treaty with Britain. That was never their plan, the invasion of Britain. That was always a secondary plan. The peace treaty of Britain would do several things, but among many things, it would legitimize the German Empire. And yes, this battle with Russia always loomed in the Fuhrer's mind. And we'll get there in a few weeks. We'll understand why. And when you understand Barbarossa and really having to do with the grain fields and the feeding of the German war machine. But I just want to reiterate again, peace with Britain was desirable. That's what Germany wanted as a way to legitimize their regime. And in many respects, it was Churchill and his rhetoric that would stop that. Certainly, the British people were in many ways divided. Many ways divided. This is a country that is still feeling the effects of World War I. They've watched how quickly France has fallen. Signing a peace treaty is not out of the realm, but certainly with Winston Churchill, and we'll hear from him tonight, and his very eloquent words, in many respects, made peace just not attainable at this time. And thus, Operation Sea Lion, this was the German operation for the invasion of the island. And understanding getting across the channel at this time was no small feat. So what we've got here is a short little piece of historical video. I think we can watch about 3 minutes of this and get a real good flavor as to what was being accomplished here. And we've had some wonderful technology help from last week that should make this very doable today. Again, just reinforcing the idea that this was not a first choice under any circumstance, this invasion of Britain. That's not what the Fuhrer wanted. Clearly, it had some tremendous dissension among the high command. And if you think back, this is the same Adolf Hitler that was apprehensive about finishing the job in the lowlands. This was the same Britain that had to evacuate 330,000 men from Dunkirk.
When Dunkirk took place, why did Hitler let those 40,000 soldiers escape to Britain without a fight? Just let them go.
A great question about last week's material, about the evacuation of Dunkirk. And why did Adolf Hitler allow that? Why did 340,000 soldiers escape, you know, were allowed to escape back to the British Isles to fight again?
But without their weapons, not even a single shell, without their weapons, after saving.
Exactly correct. They were not. And there's several reasons for that. Again, first of all, the Fuhrer was very reluctant to engage in this area because of the terrain. The terrain was not suitable for tanks. Second of all, as we said a couple of times here, peace with Britain was always desired. Always desired, and we'll talk a little bit in about 15 minutes how that peace would slip away through bombing of London. So again, I think the Fuhrer was always looking at a few steps forward, but cautiously pulling back, because Russia was always the bigger plan. I don't believe he ever had the intention of successfully defeating Britain. Now, certainly the Operation Sea Lion, they wanted to win by all means, but there were some logistical challenges, and we'll run through that in just a few minutes here. So we look at the Fuhrer Directive 16, which was the, again, preparations for a landing operation. And Germany would extend all of their bases up through the lowland countries, through the Netherlands, and northern France, where it's a very inviting target only 25 miles away. But as we know through history, that channel has saved the Brits for the better part of 1,000 years. And the Royal Navy was certainly very, very formidable. One of the big problems that the Germans had is they could not come up with enough transport ships to move personnel across that. So it's 25 miles away, it's very tempting, but there's still logistical challenges. We look at the German advantages and disadvantages as the war with Britain is looming. First and foremost is combat experience. Germany has effectively been at war for the last 2.5, 3 years. Their veterans have tremendous combat experience, and we just cannot understate the significance of that. But their disadvantages were clearly overshadowed. They lack any type of a coordinated plan. So much of the German war machine was a ground-based attack. They really were, as we talked last week, they looked at their panzer divisions as their offensive divisions, and the Luftwaffe was much more of a support send the Air Force in as early support to soften up, but they were much more a land-based military. Their lack of aircraft. Again, they could not replace their aircraft. They did not have the German war machine up to full capacity. And that's one of the things that the author brings out real well in our book, is that the plan for German full military capacity was to be set by 1944. So in a sense, by starting this adventure early, Adolf Hitler was going against his own military planners. They were not at full military industrial capacity. Overconfidence, that victory disease. They had won so successfully in Poland, in the Netherlands, against their old nemesis, France. When you win, you get tremendous combat experience, but again, this overconfidence would lead them to effectively, well, we can imagine all the challenges that overconfidence gives us, and they underestimated the Brits. The Brits had some very many advantages. First and foremost, you cannot underscore the significance when you're defending your home soil. And Winston Churchill puts it so eloquently that we'll hear in a few minutes just how significant that is. Royal Air Force pilots had the ability to bail out over their territory. They could bail out, parachute to safety, and in many respects, you know, get right back into the war. As where German pilots having to bail out over foreign territory was always a problem. Fighting over the British Channel and over the British Isles gave them fuel conservation. So many of these attack planes only had 125-mile range. That's a very short range, and thus when you're fighting at home, you're able to stay up longer, and the Germans would have to break off pursuit and go home sooner. The air bases. Britain had the permanent air bases. Germany, of course, had extended their air bases up to the Netherlands, but they were not permanent bases. We looked at this integrated warning system. Really was the early radar of the day. And what's interesting about the radar is so much of radar at this time, being in its infant stages, you're sending out pulses and coming back. The Germans looked at the radar very much as an offensive weapon. And it was the Brits that, in many respects, pioneered radar as a defensive weapon. Of course, radar would evolve tremendously over the next 4 years. But at this point, the Germans really just had an offensive radar that was just not effective for them. So the Brits had some tremendous advantages. Disadvantages, again, they lacked their trained pilots. They did not have enough trained pilots. And as we learned from fine American movies, Ben Affleck and many others went right on over and helped them out. But we did send over American pilots. Britain lacked a strategic defense plan. They had not planned for a German invasion of the islands. Therefore, they did not have a strategic defense plan. And again, with the pilots, a lack of air combat experience. So Brits had their challenges, they really did. So one of the things you want to do, particularly students, is compare these. Compare the advantages and the disadvantages. And they turn out to be wonderful midterm exam questions. The most famous British fight plane at this time, the British Spitfire. And just a few basic characteristics of the plane. It had a short range, high performance. It was an interceptor. This was an aircraft that went out and sought your enemies. One of the problems, they had a carburetor. And thus a carburetor does not allow you to fly upside down like fuel injection does. They would remedy that, but at this time, the biggest challenge with this is that it was short range. It would achieve 250 miles an hour. Now, something we'll talk about in a few weeks, this was still very slow by comparison with the Japanese Zero. The Japanese Zero would be upwards of 350 miles an hour. But sort of getting ahead of ourselves. But looking at this Spitfire, when we look at, this is the primary dogfight plane, so to speak, for the Brits. And we look at as a short range. as were the Durham Messerschmitt. Again, very similar plane in many respects. It also had about the same top speed, but only for a short time. Fuel consumption limited that to only about 20 miles of top speed. Look at that short flight duration. So these were very short, and their maximum operational ceiling is 6 miles. Again, this would all change throughout the war. 3-4 years from now, these numbers would be almost comical, but this is what was what they were looking at in 1940. When you look at the air assets, not a huge difference here. Not a significant difference. We see Germany has more total planes. They've got the faster climb rate. Their planes seem to have a faster maximum speed. But really, as our author kind of tells us over and over in the reading, when you look at this early stage of the Battle for Britain, any differences in the planes were much more operators than they were the machines themselves. And looking at the tactical considerations, that's where that pilot experience would come in so valuable. So again, we can parse through who had the better planes, but I guess like most things in life, who had the better human assets. Germany encountered some tremendous operational problems. Bad weather is seemingly always the challenge in Britain. To a year and a half ago, I spent summer there, and it just seemed to rain every single day. Germany had their resources spread too thin. And one of the things that's easy for us to do 60 years after the fact, with all the best research in front of us, is to make these critiques. But they were spread across an entire line, sending out 1,000 sorties a day, and reality was they should have had a little more what we might call precision bombing. Now, that's sort of always been an oxymoron, even in 2013. And of course, you send your fighter planes out to protect your dive bombers, and again, they had a high loss rate on the dive bombers. And that's something Britain was very astute in attacking. Britain was very astute in going after those dive bombers, not necessarily the Messerschmitts that were the dogfight planes. When you just look at this geographically, understanding, like I say, it's just such a small area from France across the channel, 25 miles, and you can see some different security rings that were set up based upon the, you know, the miles that each plane had. This also reflects some of their radar capabilities, but radar, again, under any circumstance, was at its most infant stage at this time. Look at the number of German bases. We've got just scores of bases, but those are temporary bases. And so they have far more bases than Britain does, but certainly with permanent bases and permanent airfields came some natural advantages. The Germans were winning this. This was a multi-stage attack, and they were winning, but not fast enough. Not fast enough. And this is a very significant point, and really, it kind of goes to your question a little bit earlier as to why Germany was holding back, why they let the escape at Dunkirk. Rules of war at this time, you wanted to avoid terrorism, and bombing civilians was terrorism, and thus, if you were doing indiscriminate carpet bombing of the city of London, that would brand you as a terrorist, and there would be ramifications for that. So early on here, London was not targeted. You were targeting the various military assets. And that was a strategic decision made by the Germans. Again, they were winning, not winning fast enough, and it was not part of their plan. Now, clearly any war, from one quick second, from start to finish, evolves in so many ways. And World War II would ultimately evolve into the total war. And we'll see more of that when we look at the final bombing of Tokyo and, of course, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Yes, sir?
Yeah, was the United States involved on the side of Britain during this time?
At this time, we are not. We are sending over a small number of pilots, literally less than 100. And we really do not have what we call the lend-lease program up and running yet. That would come. Well, this would push us on neutrality.
Would that have been one of the reasons why Hitler didn't want to support this immigrant? Because of the involvement, possible involvement of the United States?
You know, I think partially, but not necessarily. Remember, the United States had been in a period of isolationism for the better part of the last 11 years. Britain was still the world empire. And in many respects, Adolf Hitler wanted that British respect. So was the U.S., I mean, yes, it was a consideration, but I don't believe it was a strong consideration. I really do not. The idea of earning legitimacy from Britain was the primary thing. George, you got some comments on that?
I think the other thing you have to look at is our role, the United States' role, in the late 1930s, early 1940s. We're the equivalent of the Chinese to the United States today. We were the economic power that was menacing everybody. Now, if your largest economic power, Britain at the time, remember that by the 1940s, everything is equated to the British pound. If the British are getting their heads handed to them, and you can make money by selling things, you're going to do it. But you don't have to come running to their aid. If you run too quickly, what's going to end up happening? You're going to end up giving your stuff away. So Roosevelt's policies, if you look at them, are rather constrained. Yeah, he's saying, I'll help you, I'll give you lend-lease, I'll do these things, but he doesn't do it what?
Talking about the famous fireside chats?
Well, the fireside chats were going on all through the 30s.
But it was leading up to this.
Right. Remember, the tacit U.S. policy. If you're Roosevelt, you want to come out of this whole experience in what? The top country in the world. It has to be in the back of his mind. Remember, the British up to this point are the leaders. They're the imperial leaders. Sun never sets over the British Empire, right? We're the ones that are selling. We're trying to break through. Your competitor is in trouble. What happens? You want to make sure that your competitor continues to struggle. It's too bad. You're in a war. Well, let's buy things from us. But we're not going to come running to your aid. We're not going to load the ship to the gills and give it to you. Sell it to you. And remember, it's lend, lease. Lease means what? Pay, rent. The idea was, we'll give it to you, but you're going to have to eventually what? Pay. And I think the analogy is, if my neighbor's home is on fire, I'm supposed to lend in my what? Garden hose. Well, the garden hose, last time I checked, doesn't quench the fire, right? The fire department comes with a garden hose, you got a problem. Might help you in the interim, maybe wet the thing down until the real people show up. And maybe Roosevelt knows that eventually he's going to get stuck in it. And we'll talk about that during the Pacific thing. We're not shocked, even though we are surprised at Pearl Harbor, we must have had a sense that some of this might have been coming.
And one little follow-up, this is taking place in the summer and the fall of 1940. What's taking place in the United States in November of 1940? An election. Roosevelt is running on a platform of keeping us out of war. So London is targeted. London is bombed, and effectively it resembles an earthquake. Remember, this is really arguably the leading city on the planet this time. And Britain, while they have held off the German advances, their resources are virtually depleted. War has come home in a way that World War I never did. And massive infrastructure development, living in a siege of war, and really just this fear, this absolute fear, which is why this bombing cities is equated to terrorism. Yeah, most of us during the Cold War remember growing up with these duck and cover drills. This is where they originated from. In Britain, during the bombing. And these must have been the strongest wooden desks in the world if they would protect these kids. I love showing in my history classes a cartoon, if you guys remember from our experience here in the States, Bert the Turtle, teaching us to duck and cover. But that's where this comes from. And this was the original duck and cover as a way of sort of riding out the impending bombs and earthquake. I think it tells us that in the midst of any tragedy, life always does go on. And certainly, despite the horrors of war, we need milk. George, you give us a little video on here, please.
In September, the Germans began their nighttime blitz on London. By now, both sides had abandoned the policy of avoiding civilian casualties.
When you're ready, said God, that your streets are overrun with the homeless and the hungry and the odd. Not to mention, said God, that your buildings by the ton are succumbing to an aerial assault, and the palace of your king has a plastic community. Crazy Cockney, the blitzkrieg's but begun. It's your diet modulation by the stubborn hesitation. What about capitulation? Says God.
Now a staff officer at the Air Ministry, Arthur Harris watched the blitz with the chief of the air staff, Sir Charles Portal.
Yes, I remember the night well. You could see St. Paul standing out amidst the flames. And I told Portal, who was still working down in his office, I said, you've got to come up and see this because it's something that will probably never occur again on the earth, but if it occurs again, it's worth seeing. And I said then, well, they're sowing the wind and they will reap the whirlwind.
In retaliation, Churchill urged the RAF to begin mass bombing attacks on German cities. The Prime Minister knew that if public morale was to survive the Blitz, Britain had to be seen to be hitting back. After Dunkirk, any land attack was out of the question. To a desperate nation, the only weapon available was the bomb.
And I think we take this for granted in today's warfare, but like you said, this was the last attempt, a desperate nation, and thus Britain would start sending sorties over toward Berlin. And very, very short effective rate really was just, the targets were virtually unhittable. But as Churchill stated, it was much more for morale. Yes, sir, you had a question.
What most people don't understand is that England actually attacked German cities before they weren't on a massive scale attack. And then the original German attack on London was an accident.
And that's really interesting for those who hear that. Yes, reaffirming that it was England that would send their attacks toward the German cities first. They did that first. And indeed, in many respects, it was, quote, a mistake to attack these cities.
If that was the British motto, not to attack civilians and cities like this. Did that last throughout the war? No.
Not at all. But it wasn't this kind.
Look at Dresden. There wasn't a soul alive. 630,000 people in three nighttime attacks. That wasn't humane. It was an undefended city.
Well, you're exactly right. And part of what, one of the challenges when we study history is, remember, we know the ending. So it's really, I just want to remember to caution us, you're exactly right, sir. Try not to read ahead just yet, because right now, the destruction of Dresden, the firebombing of Tokyo, this has not happened, and it's not even on anybody's radar. And it shows you how war evolves, and this really evolved to the absolute total war, and you're right, we've got some photos that have just showed up the very horror of that. Yes, sir.
So originally, Britain was not attacking cities. They, I think the gentleman already said that in one way. They were attacking anything to do with shipbuilding, ammunition, anything like that. But there was a navigational error one night. So they dropped some bombs on the city. Hitler was enraged and said they'd do it to us, we'll do it to them.
Saying the German planes that first bombed London were accidental navigation.
I don't believe that. I don't believe that. No, not the book I read.
Well, the ones I read said that because they said that it was just the one flight. They had not been told the bomb landed, but they got lost and stuff, and they were under attack, so they just dropped their bombs. So it kind of both sides it started.
And again, I think what we can clearly agree on is that both sides were very reluctant to bomb civilians. Yes, that would become wholesale as the war would evolve, but at this time, very reluctant. You have a comment?
Yeah. While this was going on, before the Germans started their famous blitz on London, they were going after DRA. The first stage of Operation Sea Lion was to win air superiority over Britain. However, when Hitler got really angry and shifted all his bombers to attack London, the RAF almost breathed a sigh of relief. I know how that sounds, but it really almost, it pretty much saved them. I mean, if the Germans would have just kept it up, they would have wiped the RAF off the map and would have been cleared to invade England.
That's a very astute point, and community members, I just find it hard not to be impressed when young people looking at history 70 years ago wonderful points of research. So well done, sir. Well done, good point. So we look at this, and again, the devastation of London just almost cannot be overstated. And yes, later in the war, this might be common, but at this time, this is really where total war is manifested. And interestingly, our total war theory comes from the American Civil War. You look at the growth of total war from the U.S. Civil War through something called the Boer War in South Africa and the Brits onto World War I and then World War II, really manifesting an idea called total war. So Operation Sea Lion would be canceled. The German Air Force was repelled, and Britain was saved. Again, the damages were tremendous, tremendous. And we talked about it earlier, some reasons why it was canceled. The German Air Force is just sustaining far too many losses. That was a big problem. It didn't appear this was going to be viable, and more importantly, Adolf Hitler knew he had to save his Air Force for his next move. What was his next move, remember? Where was he going next? Off to Russia. So Russia is always in the back of his mind at all times. Like I said, always sought negotiations. And I really, the more I read of this, the more I'm just convinced that that was the plan. It really was. Seeking these negotiations, offering to allow Britain to maintain their colonies. What Adolf Hitler was interested in was a return of World War I colonies that were lost, and that would be in Africa, modern-day Togo, and modern-day Namibia. You have a comment, sir?
I truly believe that Hitler had a lot of respect for England, and he was convinced that he could convince their people to go against their government if he could just cause enough damage.
And you know, that's a pretty good strategy. I like the way Ralph worded it. He was convinced that he could convince their people. Well, maybe he had not heard enough words from Churchill. Because I think Churchill verbally would have put a stop to about anything.
They're both great orators.
Very true. So we look at this decisive battle, yet very costly on both sides. Yes, Germany would lose. Yes, Britain would win. But winning and losing, as we say, it's rarely a football game. It often creates losers on both sides. And remember, neither side truly has the ability to reproduce their plays. That ability would come. Lend-lease would come. Of course, the United States would find their way into the war. But none of that's happened yet. None of that has happened yet. So we look at just these numbers, and we see some tremendous, if you recall, that's about a 60% casualty rate on their aircraft, which frankly were more important or more valuable than pilots, because the pilots could be replaced, the aircraft could not. So we see there is a tremendous cost to this. Last 300 years, Britain has been the colonizer. They have been the aggressor. Except for those, pasty old Americans that kicked them off the continent. They pretty much have had their way around the globe. The British Empire still, of course, maintained the crown jewel of India, not knowing they would lose that 9 years later. But Britain had not been in a position where their very existence was threatened. They've always been the one doing the threatening. George has a wonderful thesis in all of his classes. Pretty much everything in history is Britain's fault.
But didn't Britain always count on the United States to bail them out if they really got into trouble?
You know, again, that's a subject. I'm not convinced of that at this time. Remember, this is September of 1940. You just don't know what the future is going to be. A, Roosevelt may not get elected. Roosevelt is attempting a third term, which has never been done. You do not have any concrete agreements. And remember, we're still in the midst of a Great Depression. By no means is our economy in any type of war manufacturing. Our mobilization is, Roosevelt would institute a draft, but by no means are we mobilized. So at this time, at this day, the United States, it had help available, not much at all. Never envision us becoming the arsenal of democracy that indeed would take place.
And you're correct in a way, the post-World War II world, We have supported the British on their adventures. But prior to this time, we were really reluctant to jump in. You got to remember that the 1920s and the 1930s, our foreign policy is pretty much let's hide behind the shores and not do too much. And that's why Hitler was able to flourish through the 30s. We really never took him to task. So we were actually a kind of a complicit actor in the rise of fascism.
Well, today is a very important day for me. 68 years ago, we left my hometown, escaped the Russians, but one day, otherwise there would have been rape of my sisters, my mother, my grandmother, and everybody else, which was female. And not just rape, gang rape, and then slaughter. And the German women knew that. They were frightened by it. My aunt, she lost her husband in Russia, and lost a son on the third day of Barbarossa. So she was all alone in Berlin. So we left, we tried on the 19th of January, 1945. People came out of the theaters, and out of the bars, said, well, you guys go on. You go on your way to the train station. Well, we had no luck because it was absolute chaos. Babies inside, mothers outside, and vice versa. We were a party of 15 people, and we did not want to leave anybody behind, so we just went home. 2 days later, we tried again, and my dad worked in a defense industry. We were building ships and tanks. He sent us two men to sort of keep our rear open to be able to get in at one rush. That was the luckiest day of our life. Because a day later, the Russians were in my hometown. One day. I was 9 years old. I remember virtually every speech Hitler gave. And some of them were ugly speeches from the Germans. I was never for national socialism, I was never for communism, and that's the reason why I came to the United States. They had a program here, it was sort of a Marshall Plan for civilians. It was called Refugees from Communism. And I fell under that category. And I was very happy I could get that answer from.
War has two dimensions to it. You can see it from the side of the victors, but often it's the side that we don't hear, the stuff that we don't hear. And I'm glad you're able to share this with us. If you don't understand all of that, I'm glad you're here with the class. Any other questions?
Sir, I have myself full confidence in the order that you gave. If not, things ejected, and if the best arrangements are made, and they are being made, we can prove ourselves once more able to defend our.
Possibly the finest orator ever. We just really want to hear his speeches.
I don't know. To ride out the storm of war and to outlive the menace of tyranny.
Yeah, let's go just freeze that. We can get the plan B there, George, because it's just worthy of hearing. But again, place yourself at this point. Britain has defended its island, but by
no means. Sir, I have myself full confidence that if all do their duty, if nothing is neglected, and if the best arrangements are made, and they are being made, we shall prove ourselves once more able to defend our island home, to ride out the storm of war, and to outlive the menace of tyranny, if necessary be yours, if necessary alone. At any rate, that is what we are going to try to do. That is the resolve of His Majesty's government, every man of them. That is the will of Parliament and the nation. The British Empire and the French Republic, linked together in their cause and in their need, will defend to the death their native soil, aiding each other like good comrades to the utmost of their strength. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. And if, because I do not for a moment believe, this island or a large part of it was subjugated and starving, then our empire beyond the seas, armed and guarded by the British fleet, would carry on the struggle until, in God's good time, the new world, with all its power and might, steps forth to the rescue and the liberation of the old. In September, October of 1940, virtually the entire European continent is controlled by the German army. The British Isles have held off attack, but by no means are they in any position to resist the Germans on the mainland. All they've done is saved their island. Remember, there was no ceasefire. There was no formal discontinuation. Simply, the German sortie stopped.
You still had troops in France, you still had air defenses, but they simply stopped the attack as they were turning the war machine toward another direction, toward Russia. So Britain, they don't know if this is a temporary lull. They don't know if Germany is never to come back. Are there going to be peace feelers, which Churchill is certainly going to reject. But what they do know is that they're alone, and they are very much alone. And they would be there for a while. Again, the United States, we're involved in an election where both candidates are running on keeping us out of war. We still have no taste whatsoever for an international conflict. We've got a draft of conscription, but we've also got what we call neutrality acts that prohibit us from being dragged into this war, very much like World War I. So I think in all respects, the Brits had every expectation of being alone. And the world, you know, really, what was to stand in the way of the German army? So this is where we're at. This is where we're at with the reading right now with our chapters with students. Just a quick recap, what you guys need to be looking at is, what were the German goals? Were they met? What were German advantages? What were British advantages? And looking at those compare and contrasting questions, those are really how you study this as a scholar. That's the important thing, is looking at advantages, disadvantages, what were goals, what were options? And in many respects, as British, what would your future be? I mean, this cartoon very much sums it up. Questions or comments that you guys have? Yes?
In our book, I know that it's saying that Britain stayed alone, but there were a lot of different countries that supplied pilots to their Air Force. 5% of them were Polish, and they actually run it for a lot of German casualties.
Very true. They had some help. There were governments in exile, as we call it at that time, and people, refugees, who would flee to England. So yes, they had some help. They had the greater English Empire of which they could draw people from. But this time, there was nobody standing up to fight with them because their allies, the French and the Polish, were already, crushed. The French were giving no viable resistance at this time.
Britain was fighting worldwide Germany across several different battlefields in Africa.
Exactly true. And as he brings up the idea that this is already a global war, and there are several different battlefronts. And that sort of leads us to next week. George, what sort of recap what we're going to talk about next week?
We're going to look at three issues next week. One is if the war was to end today, at this point, what would be the outcome? That's first of all, consolidating Hitler's gains. Why couldn't he do it? Why didn't he just stop? Why did he persist in pushing into Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria? And then we're going to look at the wild card next week, the Balkans. Or as I put my subtitle, Men in Kilts Save Democracy. Okay? Because if it wasn't for the Greek and Yugoslav resistance, which collectively held off the Italians and the Germans for the longest, if you add all everybody else's efforts to that point up, that didn't equal the Greeks. And those who lived through that period, remember, Britain is bottled up. They can't leave the island anymore. They're not strong enough to fight with their armies against Hitler. He's pretty much free to roam throughout Europe. The Soviets are in a stalemate. We're going to talk about the third element because, with the von Ribbentrop-Molotov non-aggression pact in October of 1940, their allies are the Soviet Union. And I told you the story, I think, a week or two ago. They're sitting in the bunker. Ribbentrop is talking to Molotov, and they're being hit by the Brits. And Ribbentrop is trying to persuade Molotov, help us out. You know, and Molotov looks at him and says, if you're winning against Britain, why are we sitting in the bunker? And he's not convinced that the Nazis are pure. So we're going to talk about that as well. And we're going to find out a little bit more about Tito and the partisan resistance.
That's what I was going to say. Tito was the only man capable of holding those nations together.
Well, the joke
was, as soon as he was dead, everything fell
apart. Yeah, well, the joke was that obviously, as Tito was lying on his deathbed at 80 plus years old, they probably had the life support system going overtime because he was the only uniting factor. And why that all fell apart, we'll explore some of that, but we won't get too deep into that because really that's a post-World War II topic. But what is interesting is the Balkans paid an extraordinary price for screwing up Mussolini and his aggression. You know, we'll talk a little bit about Mussolini and how Hitler viewed him as the...
And the Catholic Church. A lot to do with the Balkans.
We'll look at Mussolini and his aggression and how he was really viewed by Hitler as the senior partner. Mussolini was respected by Hitler. Hitler wanted to be like Mussolini. Except that Mussolini, by 1939, 1940, he's feeling his style cramped. And he feels that he has to jump in the game and get territories and be aggressive, and he's not going to get any consolidated gains if he doesn't get involved. And he looks at Albania, Yugoslavia, and Greece as an easy pickover. And we'll talk about the famous one-word response that resonated around the world next week. Obviously, when you start at the end of June to try to push it, you know, we talk about how history is important, and I tell my students, because they say, well, we study history so we don't repeat the same thing over and over, and I say, hogwash, you don't do that. You just learn from information so you have better circumstances, because if we'd learn from our past, we never had one war. We'd only have one attempt at peace, right? We have one genocide in life. That doesn't happen. We have repetition. We hopefully come with a better set of lenses to look at an issue and try to deal with the issue as it occurs and minimize it. And clearly, yes, starting out 8 weeks later, boosts up Hitler. And the fact that he doesn't have paratroopers, what does that do to him? Nobody dropped behind those lines because you spent them all in Crete, trying to drop them on British air bases, and they got shot down.
They got shot down. As far as war is concerned, if every school in the Western world would be made to read the book All Quiet on the Western Front, there would be no more wars, period.
Well, I think that one and Stephen Craig's Red Badge of Courage should be obligatory reading for all students because the same thing.
If you were put in possession of that book during Hitler's time, you ended up in a concentration camp.
Oh yeah, well they burned those books. They didn't want those books around. Others.
German national goals. What about Hitler's personal goals?
For next week.
What was driving him?
What was driving him? And that becomes more and more muddled as the war goes on. We're not seeing a clear plan. He starts the war with some lucidity. As the war continues, he becomes more and more elusive. And there's conflicts between the staff, and then we also have this tendency of those trying to win favor with the war. At all costs, they're looking for the personal anger at that as opposed to what? The good strategy, the sound warfare. And let's be honest, he attacks those that come with sound warfare. If it doesn't fit his plan and move forward, he gets upset. And what happens is now, it's just like a bad boss. He tells you to do something, he doesn't care how you do it, just do it. He doesn't care what cost it happens. So what happens? People start shutting down. They figure out the pre-solution is, tell him what he wants to hear, because if you don't, you're gonna get off. So that's what's gonna happen.
This gentleman over here.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
I think we checked the record. The Spitfire got all the credit, but the Hurricane had a better kill record. And we don't even hear about the Hurricanes, which was Britain's other aircraft.
Right. Well, we could spend a whole lecture at looking at the airplanes of this battle. You know, we could look at the Henkel bombers, and we could look at all of this. The thing we tried to avoid, and this would be good for like topical lectures. I could see this happening in the future, where we have just a discussion of those arms. But you're trying to give an overview for a course like this. It's a survey. We're kind of giving you the 30,000 foot view, and we want to whet your appetite so you go back home and say, okay, let me check out these airplanes. Let me find out about pilot training and this kind of thing, and you'll be better off for it.
I can comment on that. We might have something right here in hand. John Stevenson, is John available? John, can you tell us what you brought with us today? So we can look at what we're done here.
I am the president of the board of LST 393 Veterans Museum, that big camouflage ship down at the Mark Dock. Well, it's camouflage, so you probably haven't seen it. We are closed for the winter because if it's 20 degrees outside, it's 18 degrees inside. Actually, you don't have it.
But we have a wide variety of displays and artifacts and educational items concerning a wide range of World War II aspects, also other wars. We honor veterans of all the wars. But what I brought today was our large scale, 1/18 scale models of a BF-109, the Messerschmitt, that was the main fighter of the Luftwaffe, and a model of the Spitfire. I believe that's a Mark I. There were many Marks, many versions of the Spitfire. And these are the planes that fought in the skies over southern England in the summer of 1940. Someone over there said, well, the Hurricane ought to get some credit. And you're right, the Hurricane should get some credit because there were a lot more Hurricanes in the RAF than there were Spitfires. But they haven't made a big model of one yet. So I don't have one of those. Anyway, these are just displays to give you a look at a 3D look as opposed to on the wall of these airplanes that young men from two different countries, well, many different countries, fought a very close fight. And these were the airplanes models of the airplanes that they used.
Thank you very much. And I think what John really demonstrates is the wonderful cooperation with the BLST, Silversides, and Frank Marzak, and just the entire community. We are so lucky to have these two great assets in our community. And I just would continue to encourage us to go out and visit these. Other questions or comments or clarifications?
I still can't believe that the sailors of that huge landing ship tried to get across the ocean without telling anything to fear. And they were half to cross the ocean and go back to France to have something done for the ship. And then they made it.
Well, those landing ships, you know, large, slow ships, targets, that's what they were. Yes, sir.
Can you talk a little bit, or will you be talking at all about how people supplied, you know, either sides supplied food and some of the things, and how difficult that challenge was, and how that may have caused some implications in terms of being able to sustain war?
We particularly got a nice session coming in March by Dr. Dan Yates on what Muskegon's role was as the art of democracy, and all the different armaments and supplies that came right from the city. So that's one thing we will highlight quite a bit. And George, I don't think we have myself any information on the food logistics. Is that something you cover or not necessarily? Because again, a great topic, as he mentions. Our big goal here is to take a group of students, which we really appreciate these young students of all ages, and learning about this topic without a lot of background. Most of the students have expressed to us that they've got some cursory knowledge of World War II, but not significant background. So we try to choose a very appropriate book for them and give the overall view.
The only food logistics is when we do the Siege of Leningrad during Barbarossa. I will show you what the Russians were eating on Thanksgiving Day and what the Americans were eating. Pictorially. Pictures will tell you a lot. Okay?
Well, you recognize the World War II veterans here?
Yes, World War II veterans. Could we see your hands this evening again? Seats would have been all filled tonight, but obviously, logistically, it's kind of tough out there. But please, encourage friends, family, neighbors to come to the lectures. I don't know what else is going on in Muskegon on a Monday night in the middle of winter. You only can watch Dancing with the Stars so many times, right? America's Got Comedy.